So next drug, it is the pepsin, right? It also is the one of the enzyme which we are getting from the animal sources, and that can be given to the as a substitute those who are lacking behind the pepsin and some digestion related issues if it is there, right? So how this enzyme it is being isolated from the different animals and their intestine, right? So here you can see a biological source. It is the enzyme prepared from the mucous membrane, right? Mucous membrane of where? Which mucous membrane? Of the stomach of various animals like pig. You can see into the image here. I have given the pig up image, sheep, this kind of sheep, and a cow calf, right? So these kinds of animal we can select their stomach. We have to isolate their stomach membrane or the epithelial where the mucous membrane will be there. From their pepsin types of enzymes, it will be there for their digestion. That can be isolate and can use for the substitute. The commonly used species of pig is Sus scrofa lean, belong to the family Suidae, right? Sus scrofa Suidae, right? So that pig we are using, that is a commonly used animal from where we are isolating the pepsin types of digestive enzyme. So coming to this stomach, it is considered, if you see the anatomy of the stomach of the pig or the other animals, stomach consists of an outer muscular layer and an inner muscular mucus layer, right? So two layers which will be there, outer layer and to the the inner layer, right? So the inner surface is covered with a single layer of epithelial cells. That's what we could see into the when we are the anatomy we are studying of the stomach for human being also, right? So like that, the epithelial cells, it is there definitely into the single layer, which will be there in the inner cells or inner surface, which also lines the pith present on them, right? Different types of lines it is going to you can observe in the epithelial cells of the inner surface. These pits are about 0.2 mm in diameter, right? So whatever the pits we are going to get, the lined pits, that will be how much diameter or how much width? 0.2 mm, right? So, and each pit has 2 to 3 narrow tubular ducts opening at the base, right? So you can imagine that how the narrow tubular ducts where we can expect the pepsin enzyme, right? It will be having 2 to 3 narrow tubular ducts, which is opening at the base, right? At base side, it can open there, we can expect. So the epithelial layer is made of either the parietal cell or the central cell. If you see the anatomy of the epithelial layer, which is there in inner surface of the stomach, how it will be either the parietal cell or the central cell. So the central cells are mainly covered with almost cubical shape and secrete the pepsinogen and renin, zymogen, whereas the parietal cells, right, two cells I told you, central cells and the parietal cell. So the parietal cells are round or oval shaped cells, and they secrete the hydrochloric acid to activate the zymogen, which is secreted by the central cell, to produce renin and pepsin ultimately, right? So you can see here the physiology of the stomach, how it happened. In anatomy and physiology, central cells are mainly covered with the almost cubical shapes and secrete what? Pepsinogen and renin, zymogen. Whereas the parietal cells are round or oval shaped cells, and they secrete the hydrochloric HCl to activate the zymogen to produce renin and pepsin. Pepsin is the first in a series of enzymes that digest the proteins. That's what we are studying, the protein. So we should know about this enzyme, which is responsible to digestion of the proteins, right? So pepsin is the first series of the enzyme, whatever the pepsin, renin, trypsin, chemotrypsin, whatever we are going to study, in this series, the first enzymes that digest the proteins. So pepsin builds with protein chains and it breaks up into small pieces, right? So what as we have discussed that the protein is the chain of long amino acids, so different types of amino acids it will be there. So definitely it required a certain types of enzymes to break down them. Ultimately, if they will break down, then only we can say that they are digesting. And then unless if it is not digesting, it is not going to generate the energy, right? So pepsin cleaves proteins preferentially at carboxylic groups of aromatic amino acids such as phenylalanine and tyrosine, but does not cleave the bond which containing amino acids like valine and alanine, right? So that's what how the breakdown it is happening here, right? It is breaking down these carboxylic groups of aromatic amino acids, for example phenylalanine and tyrosine, but it does not cleave at bond which containing amino acids like valine and alanine. Pepsin mainly cleaves C terminal to F, L and E, and it does not cleave at V, A or G terminals, right? So if you see the structure of the protein or sequencing of the amino acids, wherever the C terminal or F, L and E, if it is there, it is going to having the breakdown over there, but it does not cleave or it does not break at V, A and G terminals. So that is the mechanism of the breakdown or the digestion of the protein. Structurally, the active site is located in a deep cleft within the molecule. The optimal activity of pepsin is at pH 1.8 to 3.5, depending on the isoform. Okay, so they are reversibly inactivated at about pH 5 and irreversibly inactivated at about pH 7 to 8. So coming to the preparation, how we are going to prepare it and isolate from the animals or right? So the mucous membrane is separated. Of course, if it is there in the mucous digestive tract, mucous membrane of stomach, definitely we need to sacrifice the animal and we have to separate the mucous membrane which we want actually from the stomach, either by the process of stripping or it is scraped off. And it is placed in acidified water for autolysis at 37 degrees centigrade for 2 hours. So that much temperature and that much time we need to keep into the acidified water, right? So that it can be autolysis can be takes place. So the liquid obtained after autolysis consists of both pepsin and peptone, right? So that's what in this mucous membrane, as we discussed, there are epithelial cells and some cube-like structure, different cells where we are expecting the pepsin. So if you subject it for autolysis, the pepsin and the peptone can be considered in that liquid which we have obtained. It is then filtered and sodium or ammonium salts are added to the liquid till it is half saturated, right? So sodium and ammonium salt we need to add in the filtrate. At this point, only the pepsin separates out after adding this, right? And the peptone remains into the solution, right? So the precipitates are collected and subjected for dialysis for the separation of salt. Since here it is the ammonium salt or sodium salt we have used. So that's what separation of the salts, it is important. Remaining amount of pepsin, if any, in the aqueous solution is precipitated by the addition of alcohol into it. So if you feel that you can add the alcohol and it can be precipitated out. The pepsin is collected and dried at low temperature since it is thermolabile, and in high temperature it may lose its activity and itself. Coming to the description, whatever the pepsin we have got from the stomach or mucous membrane of the stomach, pepsin occurs in pale yellow color. It looks like a pale yellow color. They are odorless or with very faint odor, translucent, grains and a slightly bitter in taste. That bitter taste is slightly. It is soluble in dilute acid, water, and physiological salts like sodium chloride solution. This is the solubility parameter. It is best active at the temperature of 40 degrees centigrade with pH 2 to 4. Pepsin is unstable above pH 6, right? That's what 2 to 4 pH only it is going to give its a good activity. If the pH will increase above 6, it is going to unstable or inactive. The enzyme gets denatured at the temperature of 70 degrees centigrade and in the presence of alcohol and sodium chloride. So that is also another temperature parameter. So as I told you, pH and temperature plays major role in the activity of enzyme. Pepsin can be stored for 1 to 2 years at 2 to 8 degrees centigrade. If you are maintaining, you can store for a maximum 2 years. Uses. What are the use? As it is the digestive enzyme, it is used in the deficiency of gastric secretion. Some people, they will be have pepsin will not be secreting in sufficient quantity and they will be having digestive related issues. So with those who are running with the deficiency, it can be used for them. Pepsin is also used in the laboratory analysis for various proteins. In the preparation of cheese also it can be used, and other protein containing foods where we can add the pepsin. In pepsin syrup also it is coming. Those who are having digestive related issue, they can use that one, right? So since the pepsin, it is the useful for the digestion of protein, which is the important part of our diet. And without protein, it cannot be considered that you are fulfilling all your diet requirement. So that's what pepsin is supposed to secrete at sufficient quantity into our digestive tract. If there is a deficiency, definitely it is going to problematic. In that case, we have to take the substitute as a food supplements that can be given to those who are lacking behind the pepsin.